Welcome back, everybody, to the last session for today. The first speaker has not to be introduced. We've heard a lot about you today, Ali, so we are very happy to have you here tonight to give us your lecture. Ali Privonalo is the head of the Laboratory of Stem Cell Biology and Molecular Embryology at the Rockefeller University, and he will be kind enough to give us an insight on what the stem cells do in our field. Please, Ali.
Thank you very much. I would like to, of course, begin by apologizing about having to change my time and presentation. I apologize if that created any inconvenience for my colleagues here. There were administrative and scientific reasons. I might address in one or two slides at the end if I have time, but I had to attend. So again, my deepest apology for changing the time, and I know how destructive that is, especially when you come from far away, jet lag and everything else. So maybe we can turn off this microphone so there is no echo back on this. I also would like to thank the organizers, of course, for this wonderful opportunity of flying me all the way from the east side of Manhattan here and entertaining me in such a wonderful hotel and wonderful dinner and an amazing honorarium that I'm very grateful for. I'm going to tell you that I'm not going to talk about two topics that are actually very close to my heart, because one of them has been published, this one, and the other one is in the process, but they really deal with the same issue. Some of the issues that I'm going to present to you and discuss with you today, mostly on published results. I have not presented this talk before, so I'm looking forward to criticism, suggestions, and comments, so that I can maybe connect my basic studies to some application or translation that might be useful to some of you in the audience. I also have to mention, of course, that the work I'm going to show you is a part of a tradition of a collaboration that I started about 10 years ago with Eric Sigia when he became an embryologist, and he taught me, reminded me a little bit of my math. Eric is a professor of physics at Rockefeller, just next door to me. I also need to tell you that for this full disclosure, that I'm funded by the Rockefeller University in this project, and also I'm a co-founder of a company called OvaNova with Noah Glasher in the audience. So today what I'm going to talk to you about, of course, as obvious by the title, is about germ cells and can we actually derive germ cells from human embryonic stem cells. This is a quick introductory slide. I'm a developmental biologist, as you saw on the screen. I just wanted to make sure, by the way, that you didn't think those were sperm. Those are actually tadpoles. I did it on purpose to see how many can recognize it, and I already know some people were asking me, well, what kind of sperm is that? It was a sperm with two eyes. And anyway, so evolutionary, germ cells come in different flavors. They're induced in different ways. In most species that we know of, germ cells are actually encoded by maternal determinants. Blue that you see here represent the germ cells. Mom puts this into the egg, fertilization occurs, segregation of blastoderm segregates those information to individual. And so you get formation of germ cells in the frog and the fish and others, purely in a non-inductive fashion by determinants that are being made. And then there's a second class, which we like to think we belong to, and I think we do, which actually has an induction, so that means it's not maternal determinants, but juxtaposition of cell types and signaling actually induces germ cells. And the most famous one and most studied one, of course, is the case of the mouse. And recently, a couple of papers I'm going to highlight came out that try to address or validate some of the information that we learn from the mouse. And there are, of course, always some outliers, just like anywhere else in the world. I have no idea why the cricket is not using maternal determinants and it's under inductive interaction, but I would be very curious to know. Unfortunately, it's difficult to get grants to work on crickets. So something that also I think we all agree has been a big unknown for a long, long time is the way primates and hominids establish their fate early on. In fact, most of the things about our own development are unknown, as you know. And so I think that was the rationale. And most people don't even know what hominids are, so I'm just trying to give you an example. You know, the orangutan, the chimp, the gorilla, and of course, Trump. So these are hominids. I apologize. I don't want to be insulting to the monkeys. So what we know about mouse development actually has always been a guideline and a path that we follow to figure out or to figure out where things come from in us. And of course, there are species-specific differences that we have learned to respect and accept, but then there are also evolutionary traits that are strongly maintained and remain unchanged pretty much in evolution. So you all know that PGCs are specified at the beginning of gastrulation in the proximal epiblast, and they migrate ultimately to a given position to generate mature germ cells and contribute to the gonads. There's too much information in this slide. I don't want to bore you with it. All I want you to remember is that in the mouse, the ligands that have been implicated are BMP, and the markers for germ cells are alkaline phosphatase, BLIMP1, and STELA. So, of course, when you start human studies, you always go by the assumption that these markers are going to be valid for what you do, and you put your quantification and your conclusions based on that. We have also learned that this is sometimes a dangerous thing to do. So I'm going to tell you about the limits of how far we can push those conclusions today. Also, of course, remind you, as you already know, that we are not, unlike the mouse, we don't develop as a cup or as a bullet. We develop as a disc. This is 14-day human embryo at 1200 stage in an in vitro attached platform. This is the code here. It doesn't matter what this actually shows. It's just to tell you that, obviously, architecturally, again, juxtaposition of cells are going to be different in a disc than in a bullet. Okay, so the story, and there has been a lot of papers published about specification of germ cells in the mouse, or even I remember when I was in graduate school, some very high-profile papers that were published in science by German groups as to, yes, that's it, we have mouse oocytes, we can fertilize those oocytes, we can put the oocytes back in the mouse and get offsprings out of them. And unfortunately, there was half a dozen of them, some with very intense and respectful names attached to it. And unfortunately, none of them turned out to be reproducible, even in the mouse. So again, I have to be careful about sometimes the difference between wishful thinking and data analysis. Recently, in 2011, a beautiful series of papers started appearing more or less from the same group or subgroup of Japanese colleagues. And basically, what they did is to derive, to show that you can induce germ cells or PGCs from embryonic stem cells. They used mouse embryonic stem cells and mouse iPS cells in this case, and the XY level. Naive versus primed. You know, these are the kind of thing I personally don't subscribe to, and I'm going to be very vehement about as I move forward in my talk, and hopefully I'm not going to get too passionate and not scare you about, but I personally don't believe that any of these things actually exist. I think these are artifacts of cultures, but it doesn't matter. We start with a 4i condition for what is called naive. We put three growth factors on it. In step one, we change them to prime. Then we change that to, we make embryoid bodies. We toss another 5 ligands at it. These are like martini cocktails. You put your goodies in the martini shaker, you shake it very hard, and then you pour it on the cells, and then something turns on, and you're happy that you're going to cure diabetes. This is, unfortunately, the trend of the field, and I think that's one of the reasons we don't really progress fast enough. And so this is, again, it doesn't take away from the credit, but the way we get there, you're going to see, is actually quite difficult. So naive, primed, from primed to embryoid body are dissociated. Dissociated cells are facts. Looking for markers like BIMP1 and STELA to isolate the cells from the population, the formation of competent PGCs or PGC-like cells from the mouse. And then in this particular paper, these were transferred in the mouse testes and generated sperm by a mechanism that's still unknown to me. I'm very curious to know about this transition because I think it will be very important for us to push it forward. And then, of course, you perform IVF on the 8th step, and then when everything goes fine, you get a beautiful mouse out of it. So truly from a cell line to a whole organism via germ cells, this is a tremendous accomplishment and really the beginning of thinking seriously that we might be able to solve that or at least approach it in humans. Another very amazing paper came out from my very good friend Azim Surani in Cambridge, who is, at least to me, the god of germ cells in terms of the number of years and the scrutiny and the resolution and quantification he has applied to it. And so this paper showed that basically if you follow a similar protocol as the mouse, you can generate PGC-like cells in humans And additionally, that this somehow is mediated by SOC17, which, as you know, is an endodermal marker, a situation that is different than the mouse, because in the mouse, PGCs do not come from SOC17 positive cells. So we already, thanks to Azim, we already had a flavor about things are going to be different, but we didn't know to what extent. Unfortunately, Azim also has to go through some major acrobatics to get this thing done, and maybe this is because of his proximity to Austin Smith in Cambridge, and he cannot help it. But here is how his story goes. He starts with, you know, XX and XY, human embryonic stem cells, red PS cells, that are primed, okay? I told you how I feel about this. He changes the prime to naive with a couple of growth factors. Then he changes back the naive to prime. Somehow this is necessary according to his paper, with a collection of growth factors. And that from this, he generates EB. You recognize the steps in the mouse here. So this is basically a very similar situation at what was done. He attaches SOC17 to that. As I said, it's a major contribution that we couldn't learn from the mouse system. He goes ahead and dissociates the embryoid bodies, fact sort them, this time with NANOS3 and alkaline phosphatase, slightly bit different markers than in the mouse. And six-step protocol generate actually PGC lights that are both XX and XY backgrounds. And this is what the output looks like. And obviously, it's not as beautiful as a mouse, but it's the beginning, hopefully, of something really good. All right, so so the ping pong game always continues between mouse and human. We started with mouse, and just the last slide to figure out to tell you where we are is back to the mouse, another very spectacular paper from the same subgroup of Japanese colleagues, but this time around, even more impressive. They kept the first five step of the original paper the same, all the way to generation of PGCs from FACS sorted dissociated cells and EB, but this time around, they went ahead and did another trick. Rather than putting this in the mouse testes, they combined them with somatic cells from an E12.5 female, and got primordial follicles, they got oocyte, they matured the oocyte, they fertilized them with wild-type sperm, they perform IVF, and here we go again, a beautiful mouse. So that is really spectacular, and Rohan Saman in my lab, who is following on this, his task is to reproduce these experiments in the lab. He's at it, and I'm sure that very soon I will be able to tell you that we can confirm these experiments at the beginning in the mouse, as we always start to make sure, and then we move forward to human only once we know that we can get it in the mouse, or at least reproduce the protocol in the mouse. Okay, so this is what the state of the affair is. We come in, of course, from the human embryonic stem cell world. I don't need to tell you that human embryonic stem cells are derived from the ICM of the human blastocyst. It's estimated that we have about 200 differentiated cell types in the adult. Outside of the fertilized egg, the human embryonic stem cell is the only cell line that we know that can give rise to all the cell types. And of course, in modern organisms, when you can perform the experiments, a single cell can give rise to an entire organism. So that really tells you that it shares the propriety of a fertilized egg to the best estimation that we can have. Our cell lines were derived in 2002 under hostile conditions. That was the Bush administration not allowing derivation of human embryonic stem cells in academic environment. It was really penalizing when we felt that other colleagues are moving forward. And rather than changing countries and going to England or somewhere else, I thought that this had to be fought here and still standing, at least up to now. The collections are called RUS, Rockefeller University Embryonic Stem Cell Line 1. They go all the way down to 12 now, different genetic background. And we're very honored that President Obama's first executive order as the president was the inclusion of my lines and the lines at Harvard as national registries, so that people can get funding to work on this in academia and distribute more than 280 labs, and we're still continuing to distribute until told otherwise. So armed with this, our first physics postdoc, Eric and I made a very interesting observation. He was not very happy with quantification in randomly grown colonies because he was worried about density, proliferation rate, and subcellular visualization of data. So he decided to play a trick that was really extremely powerful and I think surprised all of us, including Arye himself. He showed that if you impose architecture to human embryonic stem cells, that means that rather than growing them randomly in a petri dish, you actually grow them in confined geometry, circles, triangles, squares, hexagons, ovals, whatever you want, that somehow the cells behave differently than when you have them in random petri dishes and colonies. And so he would call this thing imposed architecture. And if you ask within that colony where the germ cells are, I'm sorry, where the germ layers are, we started with a very sample induction. BMP4 is the first ligand that was identified in the mouse to be on top of a hierarchy to generate ectoderm, mesoderm, endoderm. So, of course, we started with BMP4. Others have done this. Different papers contradicted themselves in the literature. Again, the martini shaker and the cocktail maker and all these kind of things. But what Oryesa was really surprising and, I think, astonishing. If you ask where are the germ layers in that confined circle, and he showed clearly that ectoderm is in the center of the circle. This is the same as this. So I'm showing you the DAPI here, and here I'm showing you the staining for the germ layers. This is quantification with single-cell resolution, so each one of these dots is actually one of the cells in this, and we can follow this not only at endpoint analysis, but we can also follow it dynamically. So it's not only where we got, but how we got there that we can follow, and I think that's very important in developmental biology, and maybe kind of neglected. So ectoderm is in the center. Mesoderm, as demarcated by Brachiuri, is a ring around ectoderm, radially symmetrical, extremely surprising, nice boundaries, and then endoderm, extraembryonic tissue, and others. Again, another radially symmetrical circle, but this time at the edge and away from the center, and you can see that. So the fact that a single stimulus could generate such an amazing complexity and push the cells towards self-organization was mind-blowing. This is like pushing a first domino of a 10,000 domino effect and seeing everything falling in place on its own. And so this ability of human cells, human embryonic cells, to be able to self-organize in space and recognize geometry was never recognized before. So we're in a very lucky situation now to be able to explore this system and ask a bunch of questions that we could, and to follow the dynamics. Albert Rousseau made a CRISPR-Cas9 triple tag, SOX2, Brachiuri, SOX17, so that we can actually move in this process. There is a lot to be said about this movie. I'm not going to bother you with because it's not directly relevant to germ cells, but you can see the dynamics of gene expression, not cell migration. So when you saw the blue coming from the edge and going inside, it wasn't that the cells were crawling out from the edge and going toward the center. It was that it was a wave of gene expression turning off the blue cells, turning on the red cells, turning off the red cells, turning on the yellow cells. And this is a beautiful oscillation that you can image for a long, long time. It's a little bit like when you throw a pebble in a pond. And you can see it happen, except that the waves are going in the opposite direction. They're not going from the center out. They're coming from out to center. Okay, so Albert and Ian and others in the lab are following this for obvious reason. You can imagine there's a lot of applications to that. And then so we saw germ layers, and I'm going to take you back to where we should be. If you see germ layers, do we get germ cells? And I think that has been a question in the field. And as I said, Azim had done a great job addressing it. If you now ask with the same exact stimulus, BMP4, what would the consequence, do we get any germ cells or not? What you can see clearly on the BLIMP1 staining, which is a marker of PGCs, that not only we get germ cells, but we get germ cells in a very radially symmetrical pattern, kind of away from the center, but also a little bit away from the edge. There's some salt and pepperness here. I can address in a minute if you like. If you figure out, if you want to quantify this effect, you can map this. This is the center of the circle here, and this is the edge, so that's a 1,000 micron, 1 millimeter circle. You can follow, the computer can track where the expression is, and the peak expression is about 380 micron, 400 micron from the center. And again, you have to imagine the waves coming from outside to inside. And to our big surprise, about a third of the entire population here is made of BLIMP1 positive cells, which in terms of numbers was quite, I think, superior than what Azim had. Okay, so what we thought we did is that we actually managed to simplify a protocol that had 6 steps, 12 different ligands, back and forth between prime and naive, flips, acrobatics, doubles, and triple saltos to get to a point. And I thought that this was a little bit of a choo-choo train. And so Rohan Salman came to the lab and decided that we're going to follow this and the original observation. And basically, what he is doing is to say, you know, we can eliminate all this crap here, and all we need is this single ligand, one step for this transition. So, of course, we'd like to think of this a little bit more of a speedier process to get there. Okay, so now what do we do with this? I'm going to show you a set of experiments here that are performed by Rohan, where he's going to confirm the fact that indeed in humans, PGCs are derived from endoderm. As I mentioned, this was proposed first by Surani, and it was in contrast with what we thought was the case in the mouse. So the minute I saw the germ cells, I actually went to Cambridge, and I sit down with Azim, and I showed him the data, and I offered him to collaborate. He immediately accepted the collaboration, and he sent us all these cell lines that was beautifully published in that paper. So these are CRISPR-Cas9 lines. They're not RUS lines, they're WIS2. I'm not exactly sure what that stands for. It's always good to confirm with many cell lines that you can get the same outcome. Anyway, in his beautiful paper, he had done SOX17 minus minus and a couple of other homozygote deletion. The first thing you can see, this is the molecular code here, is that, of course, if you eliminate SOX17 minus minus, there is no expression of GIMP1. So you see no more green. That means that endoderm is necessary for GIMP1 formation. And if you do the reverse experiment, if you use a GIMP1 minus minus homozygote human mutants, in that case, you do not get dependency. So in other words, you don't need GIMP1 to make SOX17, but you need SOX17 to make GIMP1. And that's very interesting, because now that we know who the great grandmothers of our PGCs are, and we have the dynamic tool of following them, we can ask a lot of questions that I think are long overdue in terms of finding the answer to. Another observation that was amazing that Arya did originally and my postdoc Fred Etok followed up in the lab was the fact that if you reduce the diameter of these circles, something very interesting happens in this self-organization. So this is, again, a 1,000 micron circle. This is the example that I showed you on the previous slide. If I shrink down to 250 micron, something amazing happens. What happens is that you lose the blue cells, you lose the center. The edge is there, the middle is here, but the center is completely absent. If you shift down even more, you see the same thing at 125 micron. You lost the center again. This time it's not blue, it's yellow, but it's gone. And now you're almost pretty much a homogeneous population of green cells, CDX2 positive cells. So that's pretty amazing. This is a pretty kick-ass result. How the heck cells do that? But I mean, those of you who would be able to put this in maths quickly in your mind would figure out immediately that the way this happens is that cells somehow, every single cell in this circle is measuring her distance from the edge and not from the center. So as you shrink, you lose the center and not the outside. I'll be happy to go to the mathematical support of that, but you can also take my word for it. So each cell has this magic ruler, a molecular ruler or some ruler, that allows her to see how far she is from the center, and depending on the distance, we'll decide if she will be blue, red, or green. Okay, so a paper that just came out from a talk 3 weeks ago, it showed what the molecular ruler is. There are really two components of it. There's a physical mechanism of edge sensing, very unexpected in biological systems, but we have to take it very seriously. And of course, expected signaling chemical system of reaction diffusion, or the Turing model that, again, I'm not going to go through because this is published and it tells you about the mechanism. What I'm going to show you is, as you can appreciate, that in biological system, size really matters. And so if you're going to measure things in colonies of different shape, different size, or different densities, you might actually see things that are true but are not necessarily the full picture. And this kind of things that usually we don't take in consideration. All right, so Rohan said, okay, if Arya can shrink his colonies, what will happen if I shrink mine in terms of germ cells and PGCs? So he reproduced the experiment. The molecular code is given up there. GIMP1 is in green, SOX17 in red, and when they're colocalized, they're in white. So you can see the white cells are expressing both markers. Now, if you go down in size, 200 micron, you start seeing, again, something that's interesting. SOX17 is there, the green cells are there. You see white cells at 150, the white cells are increasing. I don't even need to show you the graph. Until finally at 100 micron, the majority of the cells are actually white cells. So that means that SOX17, BLIMP1, PGC cells. And this means that you can have almost a homogeneous population of human PGCs without ever having to dissociate it, to fax sort it, to replate it, to all the acrobatics that we had to go through both in the mouse system and in the human system, that just very simply changing the radius and diameter of these circles is actually a tool to purify a given cell type. And there are a lot of games you can play with this. As you can already imagine, you can make things that are target circles within circles. You can make Pac-Mans. You can make a whole bunch of things to get the kind of cell type you want this time around by just changing confinement and radius. So I'm going to summarize my talk for you today. So I showed you what is in red here is the kind of things that we discovered, Rohan discovered, that were not expected, certainly not part of the Azim Surami's paper. And again, this collaboration is going on with Azim, and he has been very generous to us to spend a lot of time and energy educating me, my graduate student, my MD PhD student, a great colleague to have with us, and will continue this collaboration. What we saw that he didn't see was that the confinement of architecture allows induction and self-organization of our germ layers, but also of germ cells. I think that was important. That a single trigger, a single ligand BMP4, is sufficient to generate all this complexity, not only to induce all these different cell types. You know, when we talk about SOC17 or Brachyury, we're not talking about one cell type. We're talking about a collection of cell types. But all those things can happen and pattern in a completely manner that doesn't require any other extrinsic signals than the original stimulus that you put into it. So we didn't need any naive or prime nightmare. Again, I stand vigorously against this concept. I think it was not a useful thing for the field to enter this rabbit hole about 12 years ago when we decided to figure out, and others, is pluripotency, you know, the molecular aspect of it and how many cans are there. It's all an artifact. So I don't know why anybody in the right mind would spend time on this, but that we have to talk to my Cambridge colleagues. We showed that we can induce this in 48 hours. Sorry, I didn't have time to discuss that. I showed you the train, but I forgot to tell you why is the speed different. In the protocol for Azim, it really takes weeks to get the germ cells. In our hands, 48 hours is enough. You just shrink the colony and you have it. There is no cell dissociation factoring required to obtain not bad of a purity. These are our own discoveries. This is confirming what Azim has already shown in the paper, that unlike the mouse, in humans, PGCs are derived from endodermal cells, and that SOC17 is necessary for PGC induction. So we confirm his original discoveries. This is my Andy Warhol final slide, and allows me to thank the people who are involved with this. Rohan Soman, my MD PhD student, single-handedly is moving this project forward. He is desperate for help and collaborations and other support that we will appreciate very, very much. Albert Rousseau is the king of CRISPR-Cas9, world record of triple tagging in human embryonic stem cells. He produces like there is no tomorrow. In fact, he produces so many cells that sometimes we forget what to do with. And of course, my good colleague, Eric Sijia, who has always been there for us and always allowing us to quantify at the resolution where we can actually get satisfaction. I'd like to thank all of you for your attention, and I'm ready to take questions.
Thank you very much, Ali, for your inspiring talk. Any questions? Yes, please.
Thank you. I was wondering, do you think that this pattern of this expansion of the colony that allows the formation of patterning of gene expression kind of resembles what happens in the expanded blastocyst as well during development? In other words,
yes,
the patterning also happens,
yes,
thanks for the enlargement.
Yes. So we published a paper in Nature not too long ago where we showed that you can in vitro attach human embryos. You start at from embryos that are donated to us from IVF clinics. You can actually, this is the picture up there, it's a 6-day-old blastocyst, and we showed that this thing can roll and attach in an artificial substrate and give rise to the structure that I very quickly show as a movie. If you look at those structures in detail, you will see that from the onset, very, very early on, everything is radially symmetrical. OCT4, the epicore, is always at the center of the circle, and independent fates, including trophectodermal fates, are derived in radially symmetrical patterns from the edge. If you measure the diameter of the implanted embryo, it's 1,000 micron. If you count the number of cells, is obviously what we try to match when we do the seeding in the macro pattern. So when we saw what Arye saw, it was very clear that we should go as close as possible to the in vivo situation, because unlike the mouse, we don't have right now the luxury of validating our conclusions by in vivo observation. This being said, Rohan again started the marmoset colony in the lab. So we just got colonies. I got 20 different shots. I can say each one of us has to go. I had no more place left in my arms, but this is to protect the monkeys, not me. And so finally, we're now ready to do IVF. We're counting on the collaboration of our colleagues, Noah Gleischer, David Albertini, and others who are experts in egg retrieval, fertilization, obviously in IVF technology. And that would allow us, hopefully, to have a real in vivo readout. But even the marmosets, we'll have to be very careful about our conclusions, because marmosets are not hominids. That are on the lower end of the primates, is almost impossible, at least for now, especially under the current administrative and political situation, to imagine that I can have a gorilla colony. Not that Rockefeller will not be able to do it, but I think that we're going a little bit of a turbulence. So I'm not even sure if I would be able to stand in front of you next time and show you more data if, for whatever reason, I work with human embryos or human embryonic stem cells become forbidden in academic settings, which I will not let go.
Thank you so much, Ali. When you presented that on shrinking, and then you showed that it's from the outside that the cells survive, but how did you do that shrinking? Is it mechanical? Is it chemical?
So this is Fett's paper, basically, that says that the mechanism of edge sensing is a way that the cells elbow each other, and by figuring out how much resistance perhaps is on each side, they can tell how packed and how dense things are. There are really two mechanisms, and that physical sensing is a relocalization of the receptors. You know, we always like to think of receptors for ligand, like BMP4, to be all over the place, but what really happens is that when you pack the cells, the receptor moves from the apical part of the epithelium laterally. So the cells no longer respond when you present the ligand from top. All my life, when I presented ligand to cells, I took my pipette and put it on top, and I didn't see a response. I thought that the cells are not able to. But if Fred does the experiments, he presents the ligand on top, no response. He presents the ligand from the bottom, maximum response. So this can only happen when you have trans-well culture system, where you grow your cells, and you have two different chambers, so you can deliver in two different sides. I don't know if anybody else who delivers ligand from the bottom, but I would highly recommend that. It should not be neglected. That's one mechanism. The second one is the Turing mechanism, reaction diffusion. Turing is my hero. He was a theoretical physics person. He's the one who actually cracked the Nazi code during World War II. He's a genius. And so he wrote a very simple mathematical formula, a double differential formula, that clearly demonstrated that all you need to establish the pattern of a zebra is to have one inducer, that one ligand like BMP4, that induces the expression of its own inhibitor. But the difference is that the inhibitor travels much faster than the inducer. So as it gets ahead of the inducer, it can turn around and block it, block incoming signal. And as this happens with time, you generate all these beautiful patterns with very short boundaries. And that's exactly what is happening, not only in humans. It has been shown to be happening in the fish, teleros, and frogs. In fact, that's what I figured it out first, but it also exists in humans. This is one of those mechanisms that's evolutionary conserved.
Thank you very much, Ali. I think we're sorry, Nova, you got to get to the speaker's corner. Okay, so thank you, Ali, for a wonderful lecture as usual.
Thank you very much.
Very interesting.